Well, thank you very much, Raj, for that introduction, and thank you very much, Mr. Khan, for joining us here on this conversation. We are talking about the cities of tomorrow, and I think Raj gave us a quick overview of what challenges we face as far as the transportation sector is concerned and to be able to drive mobility in the future. As we talk about cities for tomorrow, it goes beyond transportation. It goes beyond finding efficient solutions for mobility. How do we change the dialogue between the government, the private sector, and the citizen? Because the citizen really has no say, no voice in this.
So, Shereen, globally, cities account for just 3% of the Earth landmass. But they are responsible for consuming 75% of the resources. They account for two-thirds of the CO2 emissions. Now, in India, we followed, you know, when America was urbanizing, land, gas, water were all cheaply available. And because they were cheaply available, you could live in New Jersey, travel to New York, guzzle gas, build limousines. You could create a city like Atlanta, where 99.5% of the people travel by car. So American cities were made for cars. They were not made for people. And, you know, many of us in developing the world, all our planners, city planners, have all been trained in America. All our architects have been trained in America. So we've learned the art of sprawling cities. The more infrastructure you create, the more cars you'll have. You know, the challenge is to reverse the process of planning and have more compact, more dense cities. Have them on the back of public transportation, have what we are calling the shared, connected, and electric vehicles of tomorrow. But more important than anything else, have cities which are able to recycle their water, recycle their waste, and basically have cities where you can walk and cycle. But many of these lessons come...
How long will it take for us to get a city like that in India, Mr. Khan?
So, you know, the process of urbanization has ended in America, it's ended in Europe, it's nearing its completion in China. In India, the process of urbanization has just begun, just begun. And in the next 5 decades, India will do more urbanization than what it has done in the last 5,000 years. And therefore, the challenge for India is to do very innovative and sustainable urbanization. And the challenge for India is to do urbanization which is based on the eastern part of the world. A lot of these lessons come from cities like Singapore, recycling water. They come from a city called Kitakyushu in Japan, totally a great smart city. They come from Yokohama, which reduced its waste by 40%. A young mayor was able to do this. They come from Kuritoba, where you can access bus in 5 minutes, so walking distance. So to my mind, India's process has just begun with this. India has been a very reluctant urbanizer, but with 100 smart cities, with Amrit program, you will see a lot of push towards urbanization. But the challenge is, how do we do innovative, very, very compact, very sustainable urbanization?
When we talk about local bodies in India, they're barely empowered. Look at what's happening in a city like in the financial capital in Mumbai. Look at what's happening in Delhi. How do you empower local bodies to take charge and to deliver on the mandate of urbanization for the citizens?
It's a very valid point because urbanization, the key challenge in urbanization is your ability to do long-term infrastructure projects, being able to monetize land value, put it back into the city. The new smart city program envisages a SPV model, a special purpose vehicle model, where you do projects and you're able to monetize the land value back into the city. And over a period of time, you will have many of these cities have elected governments which will actually, and one of the big things that's happening is that the middle class in India is getting into governance. I mean, for the first time, you've had a chief minister of Maharashtra state who's been a mayor of Nagpur city earlier. So a lot of people, which has never happened in the past, suddenly you are seeing a shift of politics from rural areas to cities, and that will force change into cities.
Okay, let me talk about the big issue that we're addressing here today, and that is transportation and mobility in the future. The NITI Aayog, along with Rocky Mountain, has put out a blueprint for shared connected as well as electric mobility by 2030 in India. It's an ambitious plan. How realistic is it, Mr. Khan?
I think there is a challenge. There's a challenge, but India has several advantages. India's advantage is that its per capita usage of car is very low. It's only 20 per thousand. If you look at America, it's 800 per thousand. Now, when you're moving from internal combustion to electric, zero emission vehicles, the amount of destruction of established infrastructure that you'll have to do in America will be incredibly tough. Mm-hmm. In India, it'll be far more easier for you to move from here to the electric vehicle section. Secondly, in India, 80% of the transportation right now is within a radius of 5 kilometers. And therefore, the shared and the connected vehicle will be far more easier. Automobile and the auto component sector accounts for about almost 7.2% of India's GDP. Therefore, whatever India does, should be technology agnostic, number one. Number two, whatever it does should not be done looking at the domestic market, but should look at global size and scale, and how does India enable good frugal engineering for India to become a center for EV manufacturing in India to penetrate global markets.
When you say technology agnostic, what is it that you mean?
So my personal view is that you'll have to keep pushing for battery swapping, you'll have to push for interoperable charging stations, you'll have to push for a lot of reforms on two-wheelers and three-wheelers. But the last word on technology for zero-emission vehicle has not yet been said. And whether it'll be electric, whether it'll be hydrogen, or whether it'll be something else, as we roll out over a period of... Because the critical point we must understand is that at the moment, the penetration of electric vehicles is very minimal.
It's 1.2%.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it's 1.2%.
Globally. Yeah.
But I think around 2026, 2027, the cost of an EV vehicle will match the price of a combustion vehicle. That's various researchers have said. And by 2040, in terms of volume, the electric vehicles will overtake the internal combustion vehicles. And by 2030, which is, to my mind, the most critical thing, the cost of a battery, and because battery accounts for almost 48 to 50% of the cost of an EV vehicle, the cost of the battery would have fallen from $273 to about $73. That would be the tipping point. 2030 would be the tipping point.
Before I get Raj to come in, let me just ask you to clarify, sir. 2030 is the blueprint that you've set out for EVs in India. Does that mean a discontinuation of the IC engine altogether?
By 2025, when the price of an EV vehicle will start matching the price of a combustion vehicle, globally, 42% of the cars, 42% of the cars being sold would be EV vehicles. And because we are in a globalized world, the global market will have an impact on India. Even in a business as usual scenario, there will be a huge impact on India because of the global OEMs. The challenge for India is that how do we enable policy to push for a more aggressive introduction of EV vehicles?
Does that include fiscal incentives or not? Because if one looks at what NITI is saying, you are asking for fiscal incentives. If one talks to the finance ministry officials, they say we have no money for fiscal incentives.
I've not seen any NITI note which talks only about fiscal incentives. My view is that whatever you do, if you do it to global size and scale, the cost falls very radically. India has a domestic demand, but India should never look at only the domestic demand. We should look at global demands. Mm-hmm. And therefore, if you do that, the imperatives of fiscal mechanism comes down very radically.
Okay. Raj, you've heard what Mr. Kant has had to say here in terms of the future of mobility in this country, shared, connected, and electric. As a global manufacturer who's been operating here in India, A, do you believe that we are going to see this radical drop in battery prices that will make electric vehicles affordable and viable for the average consumer in India? And B, how do you see this as an opportunity?
Well, two things. One is, to address the issue of pollution, one has to look at alternatives to ICE, there's no doubt. And we're fully committed to electric. The tipping point, in my view, is obviously policy shifts that drive a greater adoption of EVs and infrastructure for shared EVs in the fleet. I think what will change probably is that the notion of me owning a single vehicle, as whether it's electric or internal combustion, that's going to go through a shift. Because I think the sharing economy and this idea that I don't need to have my own vehicle to get the benefits will drive a lot of change in the mix of vehicles in the fleet. So I think it's not just ownership of vehicles, but how vehicles get used is going to go through a radical change.